two of the best characters in the game overall.
Exactly. And they're just also very good at chasing landings, too. So this should actually be very interesting, because I feel like there's going to be a lot of momentum. It's going to shift back and forth, potentially. And we're going to wait and see who's going to come out on top throughout these different interactions.
That's definitely in the nature of the beast between these two. I mean, pretty much one grab from Mario or one up air slash up tilt from Fox is going to lead into a lot of reward. But then again, Mario's so good at breaking out of combos with his neutral air and kind of floaty, weird mechanics as a character overall. But it looks like Redeemer getting the good start here.
Yeah, just straight down Simon's throat. You know, it's ridiculous how straight up he's playing very close quarters. He's closing the gap very quickly. And Simon's struggling to really shake Mario away from him.
Yeah, but actually, speaking of weird character mechanics, we just saw Redeemer drop a down throw to up air in the 60% range. That's pretty rare, but since Fox is such a fast-falling character, he goes at low angles to set up moves like Mario's down throw. So we're going to see both characters kind of have to modify their combo games to adjust and actually complete here, but it's looking like Redeemer is doing just fine.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, even in that cute little interaction we just had a moment ago, he just had great shield management all the way down low and then finally found his opportunity to get out with Dare. Just clearly strong mindset right now. But as I say that, Simon's starting to open up with up airs, up tilts, and even nairs getting in there.
Up tilt to nair, you don't really see that combo too much, mainly because you get more reward with up air, and I believe that would have connected there too. But
Just brought it back. Brought it back to the basics.
Yep.
Brought it back to the basics right there. Said, hey, we're going to do the tried and true. Oh, another attempt to tried and true. But
yeah, speaking of back to the basics, man, I can't think of any move that defines Fox more than his up smash.
Yes. I couldn't agree more, my friend.
Both of these guys, yeah. They're
especially in the Smash Brothers series, up smash is the realest when it comes to Fox.
Yeah, and both of these characters, really. So, okay, two up tilts, but nothing afterward. Again, showing Fox's kind of strange mechanics when you hit him, but usually that just means you get a lot more reward.
Oh, there you go.
I'd like to see Redeemer fix it up. Oh, and he had no jump, so that was curtains.
That was clean. And see, that's the most interesting part of these matchups, is how extra credit goes, because of the fact that they're such strong bread and butters. You have such opportunities when you already get a fresh stock to just completely advance, so.
Yeah, but Simon getting some down throw combos
of
his own.
Yeah.
Fox doesn't really have anything guaranteed out of throws, but the down throw fair into, this time he did two fairs rather than fair into up air, usually what you see at the low percents. Okay, but down throw to up air from Mario as well, a combo that lasts way into the high percents.
Still smart on Simon's fireball.
Oh, hey. Yeah, actually didn't use his jump until after the fireball hit him. Cleanly recovers right to the platform.
Yep.
Yeah, Redeemer was not really trying to bet at all on covering that option there.
Simon right now, good mix-ups between stopping short and overextending to not give Redeemer an easy opportunity to get that up smash.
Yeah, instead just going to back throw Fox off the stage. Oh, the baits. Empty short hops into up smash.
And unfortunately running towards something as strong as up smash, definitely not going to do you any favors.
Yeah, and it's so safe too, even if you do manage to block it from the right spacing, it's hard to punish. Okay, almost chases him to the corner and gets something, but Simon's still struggling to take the second stock off Redeemer here.
Mm-hmm.
It's looking like maybe the start of a one-sided battle. Oh,
oh
my
man.
God, Redeemer!
Yeah, calm, cool, and collected.
That would have been the craziest
absolutely
combo
fluid
of the day, I'd say. Oh, is he going to get the snipe? Doesn't even need to.
Oh, wow.
Just does flood into Cape, and Redeemer cleaning it up with two stocks for Montgomery. And this is the first seed NYU here right now. But they're, again, their arsenal is crippled because they don't have Ausla, the Mario, and they don't have Nixie, the Captain Falcon of ESAM slaying fame. So things are looking a little bit tougher for them. However, they did, you know, from previous seasons, earn this top seed. Let's see if they can hang on to it. Okay, and actually another player who didn't get to play last time, this is going to be SJ the Corrin. Another newer recruit for the NYU squad. He played only in Season 2, not in 1. But yeah, I mean, I'm looking forward to seeing how he's evolved as a player since April when he appeared last.
But as of right now, as we got a chance to speak about matchups just a second before, Redeemer playing his matchups very correctly nonetheless, too.
I mean,
he's just he's just getting exactly what's his. He has his very fluid moments. He may have not fully converted in them, but did not lose a drop of momentum. So the man is playing Mario with that ferocity you want to see that can definitely intimidate and back down a lot of what's standing in front of him.
Also, you see a Fox off the stage 10 out of 10 times.
Yeah.
You're looking for Flood, you're looking for Cape,
yep.
Right?
I agree. That is, in my mindset as a player, I am 100% disrespecting Fox's recovery when I'm almost any character. Any of my characters, obviously, Duck Hunt, Bowser Jr., even those two, I'll still sit there and disrespect it. Like, Fire Fox is never something to be respected. An illusion, when you space correctly against it, you can absolutely destroy. So when you take Mario's arsenal, get out of here. Get out of here. Simple. Just simple.
One of the best characters in making sure his opponent won't recover.
Yep.
Yeah, and Fox, of course, that's really his trademark downfall in every Smash game. It's like, this character is so fast, he's so strong, what's his weakness? Oh, well, you throw him off the stage and he's sitting down.
Yeah, he's very, like, super-duper telegraphed. You know, same thing that Luigi suffers from to a certain extent, too, just those telegraphed recoveries that are way too straightforward, either completely linear as a horizontal fashion or a vertical fashion is going to leave you very susceptible to just about everything that can hit you.
Right, but here's a matchup that's actually pretty difficult for Mario, a character who's
kind
of well-known for having a very diverse matchup spread. He can cover almost anyone you throw at him, but Corrin and other characters with big swords, Cloud, Marth, especially Marth, give Mario a lot of trouble just because a little stubby Italian plumber guy has a lot of trouble getting in on these huge disjoints that characters like Corrin present.
Now, out of all those characters, though, to be completely honest, Corrin does fall the most prey to Mario getting close, though, due to the fact that there is some startup, there isn't always the quickest option. So
right, there's no upbeat of
you know,
Marth, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Compared to your Cloud and a lot of other swordsmen, Mario does have an opportunity here, so I can definitely see that being a bit of a problem, but as we said, you still have to break through the barrier first.
Right, and also Corrin being a mid-weight, mid-fall speed character, very easy for Mario to combo.
Mm-hmm.
No get out of jail free upbeats.
Yep.
I mean, she can upbeat out of some combos, but still, for the most part, it's not going to save you.
Exactly. And you never want to find yourself mashing counter at all, so obviously just... And right off the bat, my friend, am I on point or what? They made me eat my words, but I talked about counter a split second. That's front.
Oh, man.
Totally going to catch hands for it, too, now. Like, that's a mad Mario. You just countered me? You just touched me? Who are you?
Yeah, even though he's not technically at rage percent, he gave him the real life rage.
Yeah, he just opened up exactly as we expected. But...
Oh, and another counter. You can't keep doing that, man.
Nah, definitely not against fireballs. There's quite a few projectiles in the game. You may be able to mess around with that, but it's one of those things where even with those minimal down frames, Mario is going to take advantage.
And Redeemer showing to be such a strong first pick. He's only dropped a single stock. Meanwhile, he's taking four from NYU.
Oh,
this is looking very promising.
And SJ is looking like a deer in the headlights right now. He's having a real hard time finding any opportunity to get at this Mario. There we go. We see some button checks. We see him getting back into it.
Oh, and he gets the charge chomp. Okay, not going to take the stock. Not quite enough percent, of course, on Redeemer, but now he's got the stage. And this is where Corrin is so dangerous. Another character that really thrives off of edgeguarding her opponents.
Most certainly, and Tipper side be a very scary option that was thrown out there by SJ.
And Redeemer just...
Oh!
The bloodthirst is too real right now.
And just the outright just mindset to go so deep, so just committed. It was very impressive. That's how you know you have someone a little bit on the retreat, bare minimum.
Okay, just gonna throw the fireball at that low angle, trying to maybe intercept the recovery, but Corrin, of course, has so many disjoints on that up B, it's pretty hard to actually just straight up hit her out of it. Oh, trying to maybe alter the timing on the block string, but it's not going to work out. That's way too unsafe.
And that's something that you always... It's cool if you get a situation, but that shield break is not going to happen with that full of a shield. Out, no chance.
Right, and that's not a move that gets extra shield damage.
Uh-uh. Just the two big beefy hits.
Okay, and a big opportunity here for Redeemer. Is he going to even lose a stock to SJ here? Okay, he's got him... Scared up in the air there. Okay, forward
there
kick.
That
should do it. Yes, there we go. Redeemer down to one stock. Finally.
And SJ working really hard to find that chase. You know, he was struggling to find any follow-ups. He couldn't get the up air. Because of it, he just didn't get an opportunity, but found that punish.
Looks like he's finding his groove, though.
Oh, yeah, there we go.
Unfortunately, lost two stocks in the process, but okay, SJ looking like a totally different player now.
Ooh.
Oh, no, and the messed up probably pivot F smash. Okay. Not quite able to spear him with forward smash. Gets the weak hit.
Nice choice.
That option coverage is too real. Pretty much anything you choose will get eaten up by the kick.
All right, looking fierce right now. SJ, like you said.
Oh, almost getting that grab, but Corrin, not really. Okay.
Hello.
Mix-ups, man.
Right?
If you're only looking to block one hit, those multi-hits are so deceiving on shield.
And just moments off of having that F smash tipper, did the smart choice of down angling it, but Mario held on.
SJ really just needs to land any solid kill move here. Up throw, now at 135 it would kill. At 128, I'm not quite sure. but he knows. I think both of these players know. It's do or die here in the pack area.
Very
it's
gonna be good choice
for NYU. They're staying alive, man. They're keeping it going.
I really enjoyed that surge of just momentum we saw from SJ right at the end there. Definitely got put on the brink very, very quickly. Put himself on high alert and swung that around with some really just solid strings. He opened up almost, what was that, 0 to at least 40 or 50? Just that one solid opener that gave him all the fuel he needed to make it through the end of that match.
Yeah, once Redeemer got to his last stock, SJ was like, all right, I've found myself. Mm-hmm. I found this group. Yep. And I'm going to keep it going. So looks like he's in the zone, too, just looking at him.
He's
got
there.
That smile
exactly.
on.
Exactly. Exactly, but he's still serious.
Okay, but it looks like this is going to be Delibird, the only player we didn't see.
Yes, so the final
MCCC.
Hidden face making its way out.
Oh, and he's a Corrin too.
Wow. Okay, right. So
double dragon.
Yep.
Double dragon. All right, let's go.
But now this is an interesting matchup because Corrin can kind of fuck up Corrin too.
Yeah,
there's no way around it. Like, those two can really go in on each other. Not always in Dittos. You get a lot of Dittos where characters are very good at spacing each other out, beating up on the options that they'd normally pick. But these two, this is going to be very interesting.
Yeah, it's funny because Corrin's strengths really kind of correspond to Corrin's weaknesses as well.
And
just
that general weight and airspeed lead to a lot of easy strings, you know?
That's what I was thinking mostly, is that you're going to get comboed for days and days by
simple setups and then trying to get away, trying to land. You side B, but then they side B right behind you. So where do you stop and where do they stop?
It's really going to come down to which of these players knows this character better overall, who's better overall at this game. And, I mean, to some degree, it could be influenced heavily by who's actually played against the Corrin more, right? Like, you know, you could be just as good at the game as somebody, but they've played this matchup a million more times. That also is a dynamic we could see. But I don't know. I really don't know how Delibird plays. This is his first appearance of the day. SJ, I mean, he basically has been a ghost until now, but he definitely turned it up in that last match.
Hey, you know, he did. Formed into reality, you know, he materialized.
Right, right. I'm very curious, though, if Delibird is one of the weaker end players or stronger end players on the Montgomery team.
Yeah,
this could really influence the
outcome. And this is the middle ground here, so this is the most undiscovered. We haven't seen this.
Okay, stylish SD there.
Yeah, I know, right?
And he's going to go down to one.
There we go.
Okay, crowd's going to count it down. 2, 1. Go.
There we go.
This is one of the last Smash 4 Collegiate matches of the day, folks. It's going to be NYU or Montgomery County Community College going into regional finals or regional qualifiers with the top seed from the Tri-State region. Okay, SJ, though, yet to even be touched, showing that he might be the superior Corrin, at least in the early stages of this match so far.
Oh! And as we said there, the side B for side B and the tit for tat, you know, these characters are going to be very good at chasing one another down and really getting up close and personal, so it should be very interesting.
Yeah, that was the... No, this is how it's done.
It's the Viosa. And I am actually quite a fan of SJ's use of the anti-aerial properties of multi-jab. They're not absolutely outstanding, but against Corrin in that big frame, can definitely do a good job of getting out there.
Yeah, being tall in this game is such a disadvantage, man. Like, in real life, there are all these alleged advantages to being tall, right?
But in Smash Brothers, it's like, you want a weird, like, meager, small character frame, and that's crazy. I can't believe that we already ended up seeing Delibird go down. I'm just blown away. I really thought he could at least make some form of a recovery, but...
I love how SJ was just dancing around in Delibird's face after the respawn, like, hey, where am I going to go? And Delibird's like, nah, dude.
Yeah, exactly.
Nowhere.
Right?
I'm going to grab you.
And I'd also really like to note the difference in just the certain aerial usage. You know, you see SJ really making good options with down air and side B, whereas Delibird's struggling to find those options nearly as well, or any option, as a whole right now.
Yeah, SJ perhaps just the more seasoned player, man. He's looking a lot cleaner. And has the edge in pretty much every aspect of the set, or the match, rather.
Just such great coverage, nonetheless. He is right there and so good at putting the pressure on it. Very odd angles.
Uh-oh. Oh, he was frames away from landing that. That could have been a kill, too. 81% would have tied up the match. But now, instead, Delibird's at risk of losing another stock.
And wow. That is knowing your character right there. Just throwing out a nice, safe aerial to make sure that even in the weird situation that a counter occurs, it's all good.
And SJ just so creative with these down airs off of the side B kick. Dropping a huge punish, though.
Such low heights, nonetheless, from those down airs. That's all they needed from Delibird. A strong follow-up there. And with all that work, SJ still went down. So couldn't fully convert. Did a decent job, but Delibird coming out on top.
He was only able to take one stock off Delibird, too, man. It looks like he had the upper hand in that fight.
Yes.
He could have gotten another, but actually, I think that DI might have been suboptimal on the kick.
There were a couple things there, too. I think he may have been a little overeager with the side beast. He was at a higher percent. He could have chose to be a little bit more turtled up and held on properly. But hey, you know, it played it out the way it was, and Delibird came out on top, so props to him. He's going to be going in. Now, who's Delibird's next opponent? Who do we got coming in here, Max?
Well, it could be either Cluey, Mikey Delbay,
the Rosalina. Would we love to see Cluey come back.
Yeah, Cluey's Zero Suit Samus, the demon. Yeah, I'd say the strongest player on the team, most likely. And then we've also got, Mikey Delbay's Rosalina, who saw actually put on a pretty strong showing, the 3DS player, no less.
Yes.
And Mega and Ike, who I have never seen. And it looks like that's who it's going to be. I've actually, never seen this guy at a tournament, and I've never played him. So, I mean, he's sponsored by Nexus, I guess.
Yeah, there you go. So
or maybe
going
his friend
on.
Gave him a shirt. But, I mean, either way, you know, maybe. So this guy, he's at least clued in to the whole tournament scene if he has a shirt like that. You know, it's like little tells like this you can actually pick up on, like, over the years of tournaments.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
You always know what to look for.
Start to get the eye spy going on.
Exactly. How fast they make their tags. I was definitely going to mention that one. Yeah, that is absolutely. Yeah, if you take a while to put your tag in, it's like, okay, maybe this guy's kind of new.
Yep.
But if you're like,
that's my favorite thing to do, though. I always fudge it because I have all the controls and everything. So I'm just sitting there like,
and then
they're like, who is this old guy? Who is this old guy?
He's probably free.
Right?
I should ask him for money.
Right? Yeah, right?
Like, oh, we were playing for one. Yo, you want to do five, actually?
Yeah, right.
I don't have any singles. It's just little things like that, man, over the years in Smash.
Agreed. Agreed entirely.
Okay, so it's going to be Mega versus Delibird.
And we're going to see
Mega Delibird. Yo,
Mega Delibird.
Please. In, like,
coming
Super
together
Diamond.
To create a crazy concept that Max is over here losing his mind over.
Yeah, in Super Diamond and Ultra Pearl, they better release
Super Diamond and Ultra Pearl.
Whatever they're going to call the next ones. Okay, so here we go. Oh, it also looks like Delibird uses the neutral Corrin, but maybe had to get off the color because SJ was already using it.
There you go.
Another little subtle thing, man. Stuff like that does matter. So maybe we're going to see a totally different Delibird now. This is Shiny Delibird.
Yeah.
Oh, but now, Mega, all right, taking full advantage of Ike's gigantic range. One of the few characters that really can just say, hey, Corrin, I straight up outrange you with most of my
moves. Ike is another one, as we saw with the hype that just got generated. People forget how much strength he packs in there. You know, opening up with two fares, pretty standard issue for Ike, but that 51% in a crew battle, that's going to come out looking rather, rather intimidating.
Yeah, and if Mega can clear Delibird without dropping any stocks, that's going to be huge. He's already on pace to do it.
And he's already won. You know, he's winning a lot of this respect his range. He's really forcing Delibird to be very surgical and choose for very specific tilts, so.
Oh, but he dropped the follow-up and
just
turned the wrong way. Mega getting kind of lucky here. A little bit of that mom spaghetti from Delibird, man. It's always have to be watching yourself.
There you go, and that's the tried and true. I was waiting to see when he was going to opt for it.
Oh.
Wow, just a moment off there, so.
Yeah, that's one of the scariest moves to recover against because it hits below the edge. It's got super armor. You really can't mess with it. Oh, but up throw to fair, you can't mess with that either.
Mm-mm.
Pretty much going to work all the way until kill percents, or at least a solid 50-50.
There you go. And that's a good pickup as Corrin continues to gain this range.
Oh!
The most stylish. That is my personal favorite right there. That's what I want to see. That is so nice.
Gorgeous finisher there from Delibird. Actually, after getting kind of clobbered for the first half of that stock, but able to turn it around. Now Mega struggling to land a kill move here. Gets neutral air to pop up.
Okay. And that's what you got to be so careful of. See, you feel yourself too much and you just get caught up in the momentum without watching for those typical setups that you're going to see when those guys are looking to come and follow up.
You know what would have actually made me cry, though, if he countered and the rage made him die?
That would have been something else.
You never know, man. Pre-patch Corrin, I wouldn't have been surprised.
No, not at all.
Okay. Oh, the mixies, though. Can't roll behind me and just hold block.
Oh, and just so lightly off on that side B.
Okay, Mega, I love how many empty jumps he's going for. Because getting right out in time. But yeah, you always want to block against Ike, so it's so scary when he comes down and grabs you and then gets these guaranteed big aerials afterward.
That's why it's always hard following up on Ike's shield. It has to be reactionary because him coming out of it with a grab, getting on a simple jab or aerial, is going to lead to these early percents that leave you in bad positioning like this.
Mega going for the wrong follow-up, though. He could have caught up air, or I mean forward air. Okay, managing to get back on with get-up attack. Delibird's still in this.
No.
Staying alive. Oh, and I'm liking now that Mega's even mixing up the empty landings with down tilts now, too. Another very safe and combo-starting move.
Bellybird opting for stage control there and getting him some mileage.
Ooh! Would have been not really devastating. No. I think he was in no danger of dying to the counter, but still, would have been a huge turnaround. Instead, set Mega up for something bad.
Wow, great choice of coverage right there. Had he not done that, he would not have been able to pull out something like that. So very good mindset.
Another stock for Delbert, who's really kind of proving his worth here now after a shaky start.
Now it's not just about extra credit. You got to come in clutch right now. Here is a huge situation.
Man, Mega just standing on the stage, taking the safe route, trying to two-frame Corrin, but instead just lets her back on for free. Sometimes you have to take those bigger risks and actually go off the stage.
Yeah, tight-knit situation right now, too, because Corrin can get so much off so little against Ike right now, but Ike needs so little to win.
Right, and he's actually unable to follow up at these percents, that time he was
He
good.
Said, oh, word?
Yeah,
oh, okay, word? Like, yeah.
Fix that face.
Pause,
real quick, Max.
Pause. Look like yeah, you know, quick. Exactly.
All right, well, looks like Mega's going to stay alive. He's brought his team down two stocks, though.
And that, yes, definitely, because Delibird was more than an opponent I think he expected.
Yeah, I know. At the start, it was looking like, wow, this guy could three-stock him right now, or at least, you know, he could two-stock him, not lose the stock in the process, bring it back to an even game. But then Delibird just turned it up, ended up taking two of Mega's stocks. And now we've got MCCC forced to send in another player. They've got Big DM, the Mewtwo, Luck, the captain, and probably best player on the team, and Jupiter, the Samus, who's putting in tons of work. So these guys have quite the roster left.
And it's going to be an interesting choice to see where the Samus lines up within this whole situation, you know, situational spread. Because I know personally, coming from a mid or low tier character, man, you tend to have your at least, like, there has to be at least one or two top tiers you like pairing up against. And with the spread we have here, there has to be at least one of them that you're going to come in. So we're going to see what ends up happening. But
right.
Now, who we have sitting down here.
That's Jupiter.
Yep. Oh, so
it's going to be Samus.
There it is.
Yep, Samus versus Ike, a classic Brawl low tiers match.
Yep.
And now both characters, like, pretty significantly improved, but still not meta at all.
No, not at all. And that this is where my thought process was starting to lead me. I didn't jump just yet, but I was saying, you know what? Actually, I think that it might be Samus time here against Ike, because this would be the place for it. You can take a couple stocks, potentially get a chance to jump out, and then depending on what the response is, if Jupiter's comfortable, which he showed he's quite comfortable in a few different matchups.
Pretty good
now.
Player,
yeah, you know? Yeah. He is going to be able to keep moving you guys forward. So that's a big deal.
Yeah, and I wonder what NYU is going to do with the rest of their roster. Mega, I'd say, is unquestionably going to fall at some point here.
Yes.
So are they going to send Cluey in or save him for last is what I'm thinking.
Well, I mean, Cluey definitely just jumped up in the rankings. They saw him perform, and everyone was like, okay, word, you know, where are we going to stand on him? And he came out and took stocks out like a champion.
Right. And I also really want to see how Luck is used in this match as well. Not the element of Luck, but the player Luck for Montgomery.
There's another character on the decline, a character that you're nearly as much as, becoming, more hidden in the shadows, more character specialist, despite, you know, the fact that the character is a lot going on. Definitely in no way, shape, or form a lower-end character, in my opinion, at least.
Yeah, but still definitely got nerfed, fell from grace.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. But Luck has still been going at it with him, so, I mean, he's one of the best Luigis in this area. And the best in PA, of course. So
we're going to jump right into it. We're going to see right now is Mega is going to at least do him the favor of not making him start again.
Yeah. Drop these two stocks real quick. In mildly stylish fashion.
Exactly.
Now, Jupiter, I can't really make it look too cool.
Now, here comes the straight out the gates. I want to see how this goes down, because Jupiter has been so on point and has been such a demon that there may be big opportunities, but Ike converts hard.
Yeah, he does. And Samus is one of those bigger characters, and she's also floaty, so she dies off the top really easily.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know, man. Ike's throw combos could be really devastating to Jupiter if Mega is on point here, but it's looking like Jupiter is kind of establishing that offensive momentum, but no. Don't run into that, please.
No, there was no need for that, especially with his Zare spacing. That would have been very uncharacteristic of what he was already choosing to show.
Right. I feel like a lesser player may have rolled into that, though.
Agreed.
Yeah. The Jupiter Man, definitely a pleasant surprise. Breath of fresh air with the character choice.
And definitely right down just to the, I love just straight off the bat, you know, so obvious to use Zare, but in this matchup, this specific spacing of it really keeps Ike in bay. And with options like this, there's going to be no simple way for Ike to get in.
Yeah, Mega's goal, at least right now, is probably just take a stock. Samus is such a defensive character. It's really hard for a slow guy like Ike with pretty mediocre frame data, not a lot of mobility, to even land hits. So he's got to make them all count. Okay, the shield pressure, fair to jab. It's apparently not shield grabbable for Samus. That is one of her struggles, is that she doesn't really have the shield grab game that every other character does because of her tether.
At the same point, though, it shows what the players need to do, and seeing Jupiter's actual stoicness in shield is really, really good. You see it. Such good press. Like, let's continue to watch this, because I think a point to build upon here is also going to be some of Jupiter's out of shield play. You know, right there, it was clean. It was really good. Even down to that F smash, it was just really, really smart, because as you explain the limited options, what are the tools he's using? What is he getting out of jail with? What is he actually punishing with? Showed us right there.
All right, who's coming in? It's looking like we're going to see Mikey Del Bay.
There we
go. Rosalina on 3DS extraordinaire.
And that's what I was expecting to see to a certain extent, too, because this is where the tier wars and the gaps start to draw, because going toe-to-toe with Rosa is nothing that's ever a non... It's always daunting. Yeah. And when you're coming at it with a character like Samus, who's already got to be somewhat surgical, I don't think that that's making anything helpful.
Also, I just heard the 3DS pairing sound effect. I was like, what was that?
What in God's name?
Yeah, but apparently that's a sound effect in
Devin,
Smash 4.
Is that you? Are you connected to the stream?
But, hey man, it is what it is. People... Whatever you're comfortable with, you know? Different strokes for different blokes.
She's sandwich.
What? Yeah. Yeah. It's not going to cause any causing errors or anything.
Oh, man. She's thin with two ends. I'm still thinking about that. That was freaking priceless.
What?
She's thin with two ends.
With two ends, yeah. All right. Apparently, I wasn't the first to say that. Yo, my man Rory from G5. He is the originator, so shout out to Rory. But anyway, here we are. I was going to say game three, but no, that's not...
Try again.
Wrong answer. Yeah. Here we are, though. Two players remain for NYU, Mikey Del Bay being one of them with his Rosalina. Meanwhile, MCCC sitting on three players with three stocks each.
Rosa's barely laid hands on the freaking... on Samus, and she's at 66 already. Like, Rosa and her damage output, goodness gracious.
Hey, man, it's the Alzheimer syndrome. Like, every hit counts double. Wow! Almost a zero to death. Mikey Del Bay with a super strong start here. Oh, and look at him positioning Luma for the sandwich on the edge, but didn't work out. However, it's looking like Jupiter's dropping some of these early percent combos.
Or could it just be Rage affecting it? You know, Rage is fresh in effect now, so it's going to be very odd, because now you're in a very odd situation where your low percenters aren't going to go the same way, and Rose is already kind of floaty.
Yep, exactly. Oh, he runs straight into the forward air and loses Luma for it, though. Trying to scout out the charge up. I think Jupiter has proven to be way too patient with that to shoot at like a 30% Rosalina.
Now, this is Mikey Del Bay's territory, though. He has done this consistently, where he has just sat back, let them try and find their way to get through Luma, and then just, you know, more or less out-durability him and get a kill. It's ridiculous.
Oh, and he loses Luma right off the bat. Samus just forward smashing him relentlessly. Or her, rather. Okay. What's your edge guard?
Oh,
was he good enough?
Yes.
Nah. Okay, definitely going to go right over that edge guard attempt from Jupiter.
Wow, okay. And Jupiter giving out no freebies right now. This has been serious.
No Lumas at all. Okay, power shield to the charge shot. Mikey's still staying alive here, but he had a huge lead. It's completely gone now. Oh, I thought he was going to go for the up smash. Every time Jupiter
actually missed the
auto cancel on his forward airs. You can do that with no lag. Oh, and wow, I was going to say, did he just drop a kill on Luma? He's been so consistent with them, but no. He picks it right up. Mikey forced to fight with Solo Rosa. Instead of playing his runaway game, he's actually just fighting straight up. Very interesting style switch. Or perhaps like the breakdown of his composure in action. Okay, scoops him up with the dash attack. She dips low like a dolphin riding the waves, you know? Oh, and actually dropping another punish on that forward air from the edge. Mikey still staying very solid, though, looking like he actually might be on pace to take two stocks uncontested.
Now, this edge guarding right now is really exerting a lot of pressure on Jupiter. You know, you really talk about extending a lead. This is beyond extra credit right now. This is potentially life-threatening, as we see.
Stall out that ledge invincibility with the charge on the forward smash. And nice, Luma was actually in front of him. He was facing backwards, so she didn't die to that up smash or forward smash from Samus. A little too slow there, though.
Oh, and Jupiter just not watching his back as Luma coming through.
Yeah, man. I mean, in real life, Jupiter is actually much smaller than most stars. So Luma, actually a much scarier opponent.
Oh, no dunks. Trying real hard, but playing good.
The Phantom Owen actually crits him with a multi-hit. Okay, Mikey still fighting here, though. He's still got two very healthy stocks. Samus not really a character known for her early percent kills, but, I mean, they exist. Don't get me wrong. Jupiter has spiked many a nest on this stream already.
Oh, most certainly. And just right now, looking for another opportunity to kill Luma and get an opportunity to get in there.
Oh, that's so tricky! Just runs right up and lets Luma do the talking. Okay, down smash. Not going to quite do it, but... definitely an ugly position to be in.
Yeah, that follow-up is one of the hardest ones to deal with when it comes to Rosalina and Luma. If you have a straight outright vertical recovery, she can stomp you back into the ground. And that's what we saw right there.
So, hey, dash attack right in the face, not prepared to block two hits. Mikey,
got a chance to get on. Luma out of the picture, and now we see Jupiter with a chance to... had an opportunity to keep Rosa pinned down there, but Rosa now with the opportunity.
Back throw fair, and now up throw up air. A lot of different throw combos that Rosalina offers at low percents.
And you can't be, you gotta be careful taking that bait of attacking in a shield. They're gonna do that to set you up on your landing.
And Mikey has been getting so much mileage off the dash attack. Wow.
Yep.
This NYU clutch, let me tell you, Brian. Every collegiate, right? Or both collegiates that have happened so far. NYU has gone down pretty hard in one of their last matches, right? And just had a player come out of nowhere. First time it was Squid Boy with Meta Knight, and now that guy's like actually good.
Yeah.
Last time, I forget who it was, but someone was making a huge comeback for NYU. And now it's Mikey Del Bay's turn to break out in his first time on the circuit. But here's the NYU curse, man, is that they've made these almost comebacks, take them so far, and then they just can't complete the win at the end. So let's see if history is going to repeat itself here. Big DM stepping up to the plate.
Right. Where is the fuel in the tank going to run out? And that's what we're waiting to see, is if NYU is able to upgrade these collegiate members of theirs to see if they have the stamina to make it full through here. And they're putting out a good fought battle. They're really breaking it all out right now, but it's going to take them to the wire.
Yeah, this is so intense right now. And they're sending out Big DM's Mewtwo, who we didn't really get to see very much of in their first match. He kind of just was like the finisher, right? He took one or two stocks, I think, and that's all he needed to do. So this time we're going to see him actually fight a full-fledged battle. It's 6-5. Mikey Del Bay's Rosalina, definitely shown to be no joke. And Mewtwo is such a light character with a big frame. I don't like this pick.
Yeah, this is going to be a hard... I've played this before, and I personally think by default you're already, especially with Mikey Del Bay coming in with that heat, he is well aware of what he needs to do, and he is converting right now. So,
but here's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking MCCC wants to save their anchor, Luck, for the very end, because he's the best player on the team.
Yep.
He hasn't even had to play it.
Yep.
But, I mean, is that a good decision? Because right now, if Mikey Del Bay rolls over Big DM in a bad matchup, even though it's 2-3, if he's able to win this and even have one stock, and then he takes one from Luck, Luck is going up against Clue with 2 stocks. This really just depends on how tight they're able to keep their margins, right? If they're dropping stocks in the process, this is not going to end up well for MCCC. But I don't know. NYU, another really strong team in their own right. So how's it going to go? I don't know. I'm really excited. 5-6, man. Let's see how this
goes. Yeah, exactly, right? This is the got no nails, man. Biting them all off right now.
Yeah, exactly. Fingers bleeding all over the place. Yeah. All right, so let's see how this unfolds, man. I'm really looking forward to it. These guys having some hesitations hitting start, I guess. I don't know what's going on here.
Yeah, we're getting a lot of coaching in right now. Definitely.
True.
On the MCC side, you see it right now. They're making sure to get their stuff right, because they know how close this is and they know what they're up against.
Clearly.
And if the rumors ring true, I'm sure they're looking to pull the rug out from underneath them, you know?
Yep. The NYU curse, man. Will it live on, or will
that's
they break
the
barrier
question.
And take home first place today? I don't know. Either way, we're still going to see more of these teams at regionals when they take on the teams from MDVA. But I don't know, man. This is a lot on the line here. You definitely want that first seed going in so you have an easier break in your first regionals match. Ooh, okay, Mikey Del Bay opening up strong. Just gets his grab. He hasn't even been hit yet. He's already tacked on nearly 50.
Do you see how high Mewtwo's already going?
Like, that was what? What? Who does that? Who is this guy?
Oh, man. And Big DM has been put on notice. Everyone is popping off right now, and he needs to do something, because if Mikey Del Bay keeps generating this momentum, he's got no shot in the dark at stopping this.
Okay, I just got to say that the short hop star bits into landing down smash, double down smash, actually the craziest thing I may have ever seen in this game, like, ever.
That was beyond style right there.
And Mikey just so aware of where Luma's going to be on the respawn. Mashes a down air right into
Goddamn's
face. And yeah, this is looking bad, man. He's an up smash away from death. Really, an anything smash. And Mikey Del Bay landing these forward smashes like crazy.
And as
literally
we said,
left and right.
The fire is here. It is. See, and that's everyone going. And this is all some players need to pop off.
Mikey Del Bay, the crowd favorite right now. It is New York versus PA, so he is the home team right now.
Big DM finding an opening now. He's getting some.
Yeah, and Mewtwo, such a heavy hitter. Like, he can end stocks at 85% no problem, especially against someone like Rosa. Oh, looking for that back air, but he can't keep the edge guard going.
And that was a rough situation, too. He almost lost himself in translation and had an SD on his hands.
Okay, Mikey Del Bay fighting back. Still kind of struggling to find his groove on this second stock here. Oh, and that's
there.
It.
There we go. Careful with Luma behind you, though. That was...
Yeah, I think after Rosa dies. Like,
I
after she's actually dead, yeah. I'm not sure, though.
Seen some silliness.
There, yeah, I've seen some things in my time.
There we go. Now we're getting tricky. There we go. And this is what we needed to see. But wow, as we say that, a beautiful gravity squeeze.
Gravity squeeze?
Gravity squeeze.
We Marvel boys now.
Yeah, exactly.
We're at next level arcade, so why not? Yeah.
We're working with it.
Okay.
Making his way in, but couldn't continue that. Loom is out of here.
Big DM looking way better than he did on that first stock here. But yeah, with no Luma, this is a lot harder for Mikey for the next 12.5 seconds. Trying to find his way in with these pokes. Rosalina, I mean, she's pretty decent at poking on her own, but she really needs Luma to become such a threatening presence. Oh my god!
Oh wow.
Eviscerating that stock.
And right there, yet again, Big DM had a chance. He was starting to feel that movement, but out of nowhere, Mikey Del Bay just cranking it up to 11 and throwing him out of the stadium.
Using Luma to tank that Shadow Ball, just not even blocking on the way in. No hesitation.
Especially on those opening hits, Luma was fresh, so he had no worry about knockback there on an uncharged Shadow Ball.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, gonna protect Luma there. Wow, so ambiguous. It's like, when does that move end? Does anyone know that doesn't play Rosalina? Okay, here we go. Oh, using the confusion to mix his landing up. I like it. Oh, and Mikey trying for some more of that style right there.
Oh, and that's a missed fair on the Luma, though, and this could end up costing him a lot.
Taking so much damage with these fairs and down smashes here. Mikey Del Bay, he just needs to close the stock out now.
This is such a dangerous situation. You're not out of jail yet, kid.
Okay, pops him up with the dash attack again. He's getting a lot of hits with that. Oh, and the Luma shot to the face. You were not ready for that, Mewtwo. That was point blank. Oh, okay, just releases him. I don't know where he's going with this, but he's got the Luma. Trixie's with the setup now. Okay, keeping Luma in front of him.
And the back and forths right there. You see it. Mixing up Rosa or Luma coming at you.
Oh, and he... he's dead!
Wow!
The DI was not there. There was no DI at all.
Oh my goodness, and just like that, he pulls the rug clear out from Mikey Del Bay. Just like that. I don't think he was ready for that at all.
He was not. Mikey was looking unstoppable for a while.
Oh, and the pop-off is real. He's loving it. That's what we want to see. That was the definition of clutch right there.
And that's the danger, man, of playing that rollback heavy style. All it takes is one read with a huge move like Mewtwo's up smash, and you could go
against
out when you least
tall
expect
frame,
it.
As we spoke about, like Rose's, where it's going to make it's going to connect.
Man, and that's so unfortunate, too, because he was only at, like, 70 before the hit. If he had just DI'd any sort of bit, he really just set himself up for failure.
But that's Mewtwo also, though. Huge attack power, you know? The DI would have saved him, but...
154 base special attack, man. You don't mess with that.
It's dead serious. That is always Mewtwo's shining grace in this game, truthfully, is just how raw he is with his choices.
Okay, and he's got to kill himself one more time. We've got Cluey coming out, the NYU monster, who... 11 stocked? 10 stocked. Mm-hmm. Their last opponents. Yeah. And here we go. Let's see what he's got against Big DM's Mewtwo. Able to clutch it out against Mikey Del Bay. I'm sorry. Brain just went dead.
Yeah.
But Cluey, man, if he's able to get this done without losing a stock, that's really the only recipe for victory I see in NYU's future. Because he's got to take on Luck, who I think already is kind of favored to beat him.
And I think Big DM has a rough situation on his hands here. You know, only having one stock and having to come in against Cluey, that's a hard matchup to just take in really quickly. ZSS, notorious for ending stocks quickly and converting very hard, so...
By the same token, though, he actually has so much pressure on him right now. It's like, I gotta take just one stock and that's it. I'm sorry, the opposite. He doesn't have that much pressure because he only has to get one kill, right?
Mm-hmm.
Chloe right now knows that it's all on the line for his team right now. If he goes into the next match with two stocks, they basically already lost. But, I mean, not for real, but still, it's a huge disadvantage. Oh, okay, mashes out of the ground.
Yep.
Good stuff. Oh, Big DM picks up the grab, though. See what he makes of this edge guard. Nothing. Zero Suit is so hard to catch sometimes. All their flips and tethers.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Chloe looking for this.
Oh, all right. But Big DM showing he's still in this. He just has to be careful. Those close follows are going to be what ends him right like that. And that's always something you have to be careful with Mewtwo. The fade in and out, especially against the character, as with as much aerial mobility as ZSS, it leaves you with a huge gap in your defense.
And speaking of raw power, man, she's definitely got it in spades.
Mm-hmm.
And Mewtwo, not a character who can take hits like that.
No, not at all.
Second lightest in the game. Even after a buff.
Yeah, you know, that's the balancing factor of him. He's still unbelievable. He got everything in the book besides anything. A touch of weight.
Glass cannon, still made of glass.
Mm-hmm.
Still a cannon, but it's still made of glass.
What was it? It was something funny, though. I'm pretty sure it was almost like he and Sheik just changed weight classes. It was like very close
to that. One went up and the other went down, but they didn't switch.
No, exactly what I was going to say. But like the weight increments basically almost look like they switched by the way that the nerf and the buff came out. It was very entertaining.
Right. I think Mewtwo is 72 and Sheik is 80. So still like a pretty significant differential,
Might be a little bit closer than that, but I don't know the numbers for sure to say anything indefinite.
Sheik 80?
Where did Sheik and Mewtwo fell?
It's 80 or 81. I know she got brought down and I think she got brought down again. But yeah, Mewtwo is 72, I'm almost positive.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe he's 74. Thanks, Kuragana Hammer, for being so godlike.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Mewtwo, 74. My bad, And then Sheik, 80? 81. 81. All right, so I was off a little bit, but hey, man, numbers are hard, right? Leave it to these collegiate players to worry about the numbers. I'm just going to say the words. But no, of course.
That's what I'm here to do.
Actually, I'm going to put you guys onto this right now. Unrivaled tournaments, one of my favorite things about them, they have a Kuragane Hammer binder, like with 400 pages of every frame data and weight and all that stuff. It's so godlike. And it's all like tabbed out, separated by character. Yeah, so just something to think about.
So it's kind of like the Bible?
Super awesome. Yeah. Yo, tablets. Yeah, yeah.
The Smash Frame Data Bible?
Yeah, the Bible. Yeah, or if we each just get like a tablet right here.
That'd be great. Yeah,
that'd be super cool.
That'd be awesome to just check on the fly.
Anyway, enough about that.
Woo.
We've got a super intense standoff right now. Three stocks apiece. Chloe versus Luck, the best player on each team here. Zero Suit and Luigi. Let's see who's going to take it home. Is it going to be NYU or Montgomery?
And Luck has still not even made an appearance yet, so this is his opener, isn't it?
Yes, it is. This is actually his stage debut at Tri-State local qualifiers.
And what an interesting matchup to be in here for, you know? This is definitely something that I feel like can go either way with Luigi's ability to slip out of combos.
Yeah, for sure. And also Zero Suit's ability to just space him out with those really safe aerials.
He's going to have to dig for it. Chloe already opening up on his huge use of flip kick.
Yeah, right, and I feel like that was working so well against some of the more novice players on these teams, but how is it going to pan out against Luck, who's power ranked, I think, sixth in PA, or maybe even higher?
Especially in the matchup just against Luigi, where he does have the ability to cover that distance. You know, if you're not safe with that, he can get in there.
Oh, okay,
but Chloe
figuring something out here. Luigi, you definitely have to adjust your combos against.
Yeah.
Oh, no down throw from Luck, though. I'm not sure if that was intentional or not. Oh, and unable to complete the chase on that flip kick.
Oh, and he's trying. As we see, Luck already sizing up a lot.
Yep, that anti-air, man. Noticing Chloe's tendency to jump in with a neutral air over and over again.
And it's real right now between these two.
A lot of trash talk.
This is so serious. They know what's on the line, and they know what's up for grabs.
Ooh, and speaking of grabs, Luigi going to take a lot of reward off just one.
And Luck pulling a page out of Chloe's book and opening up strong right now.
Yeah, need to see some adjustments from Chloe here, man. I don't know if he's used to competing against opponents of this caliber. He doesn't really come out to the standard tournaments that much, whereas Luck, this guy's all over the map.
Yeah, and you see it right now. Chloe is not finding his openers that he found before. Flip kick's coming up empty. He is having a hard time really getting anything to land on Luigi.
Oh, he went for the uppie out of shield, this man. But, I mean, he didn't even get punished for it, really. He just took a jab.
We take those.
Yeah, definitely.
And we take those all
pretty
day.
Pretty solid bargaining.
I don't know who your lawyer is right now, but you need to talk to that man.
Oh, hey. The creativity. Luck making sure he doesn't get caught on that re-grab there.
And catching Cluey being a little bit slow, but that may not be it.
Oh, and he actually missed the punish there. That
Wow, and that was unbelievable as those two were absolutely conjoined.
Yeah, they were stuck together, man, like Siamese twins.
It was, that was something else. Oh, man. Oh. And Luck is smelling it right now. Look at this man.
He's just looking for an up smash.
He is there.
Or just going to block repeatedly, but take what he can get.
No fear.
Oh! Oh.
Look at this. He's in it.
Oh, and not a trade you want to take. All right, Cluey's got to activate. We need that NYU clutch from Cluey in full force, but it's looking like the curse might live on.
Oh, man, and this is... All MCC are popping off for Luck right now. NYU having a hard time even keeping up with the noise. Just watching on is despair.
This is not looking good for Cluey. He's down so much right now. I mean, Zero Suit's a character that can make it happen. We've seen it from Nairo. We've seen it from plenty of others.
And if you're Cluey, this is not what you want to see from Luck right now, too. He is taking his time, just tossing fireballs. Look at that. Just having a hard time following up because you got a touch of rage on you. He has got you right in his palm.
And these block strings from Cluey, they're just not enough to get it done here, man.
Nope.
Nairs into jabs. Like, that's not really scaring a Luigi at 30.
All right, but now we're opening up now. Now we've started to get through and get a little bit more than residual damage, but just like that, Luck saying nice one, but not much.
And Cluey showing to be like a complete demon at the intermediate level, but here now that he's taking on an opponent like Luck, it's kind of just falling apart.
And this is a slugfest. They are just swinging on each other's shields.
Yeah. I think Cluey is just trying to hit with whatever he can, and Luck is like, oh, I'm going to block. That's all I need to do.
I just hope Cluey doesn't fall too much prey to that, playing not to die.
Oh, and Luck chasing him down. Cluey maybe needs to reevaluate how aggressive he's being. Wow, kicks him in the head though. Not ready with the up smash there.
We've seen this once before. Cluey looking to make an opening. A lot, still a heavy.
Oh, and that's going to be it. MCCC advances with the first seed to regional qualifiers
and
out of Tri-State Locals.
Luck, the hidden boss of his squad, definitely came through, held it down. Cluey.
Not even hidden, man. Everyone knows about this guy. Tri-State knows Luck is a scary player, man. All right, well, that's going to wrap up the Smash 4 Collegiate action
there
for the day. Guys, thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed it because, I mean, some of these players, you know, you're like, oh, I've never heard of this guy.
Yeah.
It's not exciting. But then you watch the matches and you got the crowd hype. Like, the whole venue is going nuts, you know. Redeemer is popping off harder than Luck did, man. Redeemer is...